So in this part of the lesson, we're going to look at arrays. It's quite a long section. I'm going to show you a lot of what arrays are all about and what you can do with arrays. Now, in most instances, we're going to perform some functions on arrays, and that's exactly what we're going to do in this lesson. I'm going to show you quite a few Julia functions and how they impact arrays, just to showcase what an array is. Now, first of all, here's our first array. I'm going to call it ARR. Call it whatever you want within the constraints of the syntax that is allowed in Julia. And you see I enclosed this in square brackets, and I put commas in between the values. So I have 10, 12, 14, 16, and 18. And when I output that to the screen, lo and behold, we have the five element array. They're all integer 64s, and you see this comma 1. Comma 1 means we're talking about a column. So if you use other development interfaces, such as development environments, I should say, such as a light table with a Juno add-in, it'll actually be called a vector, a column vector, because this is indeed just what it is. It is a column. Now let's just do a row vector. So I'm going to call this array underscore ARR, at least underscore row. And you see, I've still got my square brackets, but I've omitted the commas. It's the spaces in between. And if I run this section of code, you see the output there. It is going to be a 1x5 array, one row, five columns, all 64-bit integer values, and C, 2. This is, now I don't really want to call it dimensions because it gets confusing as far as math is concerned. But as far as Julia at least is concerned, this 2 refers to this as being, this is a row, and you see the 1 there, meaning that that's a column. Now, let's just use a function to populate an array. What I want to do is I'll just say cell all output toggle, so we just get rid of what's to come. Keep it as a surprise. So array ARR underscore rand, and I use this rand function, and it says 5. Give me 5 values, and there I have a 5 element array. They are 64-bit floating numbers, values, and they are columns. It's down a column, and you see what rand does. It chooses values from 0 to 1 inclusive, and there's a pseudo-random selection of these values right there. Let's create an array in a different way by using the fill function. Fill takes two values here, 7, 10. I've called my array 7s, and if I execute that, you see it's a 10-element array of 64-bit integer values in a column format, and they're all 7s. So the argument was what to fill your array with and how many elements you want. So 10-element array there. I can also use it on strings. So here I have a string, I love Julia, exclamation mark, and I want 3 of those. And lo and behold, this is a 3-element array of ASCII string type. Again, it's a column array. Now, let's use this bang equivalent to our fill function. So it's fill bang, and we're going to take LVE, which was our array there, and this is what we're going to append to the end. And now I will have, if we just select that section, run it, we see we have a 3-element array. Now, adding a bang to permanently change, so that is still 3. Let's run this again. I have a 3-element array, I fill it, and I add a 4th one, and I still get 3 back. So clearly you see here this fill with the bang has not really changed this array, and we'll get to that. Now Julia can repeat more than just a single value. Here we have rep mat function. I have my array here, 1, 2, 3, as a column vector, and I want it repeated 3 times. Let's run that. There we go. We see a 9-element array now of 64-bit integers in the column 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Now, using line space or L-I-N space and log space. So it goes like this. Lin space, start, stop, and how many elements you want. So you're going to break this up, the values 1 to 21 in 1 to 10 in 21 equal bits. And, well, I shouldn't say bits, I mean little ranges type of, you see, is a lin space of 64-bit values. So that's a bit different from just being an array. Now let's print each of those. So for I in lins, print line I, end, print line means it's going to all go in its own line. And there you see it starts at 1, it ends at 10, and there are 21 of these little elements. So it's taken, it's gone between 1 and 10, and it seems to have added 0.45 to each step. Log space takes these two arguments, 2 and 4, and it says divide up some values between 10 to the power 2 and 10 to the power 4. Now it's going to do, by default, it is going to do 50 arrays, 50 elements there. So 10 to the power 2 is 200, 10 to the power 4 is 10,000 there, and it's got 50 equal difference between each of these elements, and there are 50 of them in total. Let's do a few other things. We're going to create two arrays of random values. Remember, RAND's going to choose between 0 and 1 inclusive, and I want 20 of them. For both of these computer variables, vals1 and vals2, I'm using semicolon just to suppress the output to the screen. Well, in this case, it doesn't really work. In iJulia here, it's still going to output one of the two arrays for me at least. Doesn't matter. Maximum vals1. Let's run that. I want the maximum of all of those. Now, every time you run this, you're going to get something different, but it seems that value 0.9586, etc., was the largest of all the values in one. So you can clearly see this was vals2 that was what was printed to the screen, because vals2 certainly doesn't have this number in it. Vals2 here as displayed. I can say find max, that returns the maximum value and its index. So it says in vals1, this number 0.95861, etc., was the largest value, and it was in position number 1. Same goes for minimum. That's just going to return the minimum value. And find min will return that minimum value and its position. Extrema goes through an array, and it's going to give us the minimum and the maximum values in that array. Now, just some descriptive statistics, quite easy as well. I just ask for the mean of vals1. It'll give you that 0.551085, etc. Remember, the equation for the average or the mean is just summing all the values and dividing by how many values they are, how many elements they are. And to count the elements in an array, we just use the length function. So sum all the values divided by how many there are, and it's just going to give us back exactly the same as what mean did. We can also ask for the median, and we can also ask for the sample standard deviation. Now, I thought let's just include a bit of fun. Remember the equation for the standard deviation, sample standard deviation. The population standard deviation just divides by n, but the sample standard deviation divides by n minus 1. So you take the average of all the values, and you're going to subtract from it each individual value and square that, and divide it by n over 1, and it's the sum of all of those. The sum of all of those. Now let's just create that in a little function. So I'm going to create a function. So this just for fun. I'm going to call my function sample standard deviation, and it's going to take an argument x. I'm going to implicitly have these little computer variables here. I'm going to have total, and I'm setting that equal to 0. So this is the local variable with respect to this function. Won't exist outside of the function. N is the length of whatever array I pass to it, so that I know how many elements there are. And I'm defining this function average, and the average is going to sum all the elements in the array that I'm going to pass this function, divided by n, which is the length. Now I'm going to run through a little loop for i in 1 to n. Remember, n is the length of the elements, so it's going to run through all of the elements. It's going to total, which is 0 when we start, it's going to update the total with the average minus whatever element I am at the moment, and square that. So that's going to be this numerator bit here. And run through all of those so that I have a total, a new total. Now, total existed outside of this for loop, so it is explicit as far as this for loop is concerned, but it's still implicit, it's still a local variable as far as the function is concerned. But I can return something, the square root of the total, which is now updated all these differences between each element and the average, and divide by n minus 1 and take the square root of that. So there's my function. It's a generic function with a single method, because I, which is any, because I really didn't specify anything as far as limiting what x should be. Now let's use our function sample standard deviation, and I pass it the vals 1, and it returns 0.314. What was the standard deviation? 0.314. Let's just make doubly sure. I'm going to say, is Julia's standard deviation equal to my sample standard deviation function? And of course, that's going to return a true. Now we've seen maximum and find max, and minimum and find min. I just want to show you what max and min does. Max and min will look through more than one array, and it'll go element by element, and it's got to be of equal length, these elements. I have, so that they've got to have these pairs, and it'll just return the maximum of the two. And same for minimum, it's going to return the minimum of the two. Now we can perform element-wise operations. So I can ask this Boolean question for vals 1 and vals 2 dot smaller than. So it's going to compare the first element in vals 1 and the first element in vals 2 and see if it is smaller, and then run through all of them. And it'll return this Boolean. It'll return this Boolean values here. So false if it's not smaller than, and true if it is smaller than. Now I can perform this little change the value. So I'm going to say in vals 1, and then these square brackets, if vals 1 is less than vals 2, set that value in vals 1 equal to 100. I'm just using a large number. Now if I ask, is everyone in vals 2 less than vals 2, and they will all be false, because the ones that did return a true were now suddenly changed to 100. Almost getting to the end of this section of the lesson, let's do a few more things. Remember the collect, it's going to start at 1, increment in values of 2, and end at 21. I'm going to add that to odd, and you see odd is now OD, I shouldn't say, just OD I called it, as an 11 element array. 1 there, it's a column vector, 1 to 21. Now I can use the find function, and that's just going to return the index value. So find is odd in that. So which of those are odd values? And it says 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, all of them. All of them were odd numbers, and they were indeed all odd numbers. So the find function here is going to return just the index value for me. Return all the prime values for me in that. And it gives me that, but it's the index of that. So if you wanted the actual values, you have to do this. Give the variable name, then find is prime in odd. Because in this square bracket, it's just going to return an index. So it's going to show all the values in this OD that are actually the prime numbers. And you see them there. Remember, one is not a prime number. We can just use this normal start stop instead of collect, so I'll call it nums, but just remember this is a unit range, it is not an array. If I use collect, it's with start, step, and stop, I can create an array, but if I just use this range notation here, 80 to 100, it's going to have the values 80, 81, 82, but as a unit range. Now I can still iterate through it, because I can just say any is prime numbers. And it says true, so the any is just going to return a true. It's just asking the question, are there any prime values between 80 and 100? Yes. Find the prime numbers between 80 and 100. And now you say 4, 10, and 18 you see there. So once again, you can see what it returned. It returned the indices for me. So if I wanted to return the actual values, I've got to have the indices. Since these are the indices, I specify them for nums, and that returns for me the three element array 83, 89, and 97 are prime numbers. Filter, it's going to do the exact same thing for me, but just give me the values all in one go. The all function on an array, all is in integer nums. Yes, indeed they all are, so they've all got to be true for this to return true. So if I ask, are they all even, it's just going to return a false. No, they are not. Now, just for a bit of fun, I'm going to go to the type max of my 32-bit integer values. I'm going to subtract 10 million from them, and then have this unit range from that till type max. I'm going to have this 10 million values. And so You see there from that value to that value. And I'm going to use this macro at time to time, finding all the prime numbers going through this list of 10 million very large values. Now, the first time I run this, it's a bit of a cheat because Julia's got to compile and everything, not just execute it. So the first time that you run this, it's going to be very slow. The second time, the code has been compiled, optimized for the for my CPU in this computer, and it'll show the proper timings of all of this. And the first time, as I say, this one is going to be very slow. Remember, I've got 10 million very, very large values for it to go through. And there you go. You see it found 465,817 elements. So that's prime values in those last values. And you see the runs took how long they took. And you see the 0.72% GC time that it took. So you can play a bit with that, run that code again, you'll see what happens. See the large memory allocation that was required to do that. So let's just have a small little array, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And very last thing in this, I just want to show you combinations and permutations as it can be used on arrays. So collect for me all the combinations in CH and make 3. So take 3 of any of these and see how many combinations we can come up with. Let's run that, and it says you can have 1, 2, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 1, 3, 4, 1, 3, 5, 1, 4, 5, 2, etc. You'll see it's a 10-element array. Permutations works a little bit different. You can't choose how many of the elements you want to choose. It's just going to go through all that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and come up with all the different permutations. And if you know the equation for permutations, you'll can calculate that there are exactly 120 permutations. So quite a long section of this lesson. This is going to be a very long lesson because I'm introducing both collections and just giving you a showing of what can be done with them. Next up, we're going to modify our arrays.